We've got a new PowerPoint layout, so I guess that means you're on to a new philosopher. We're going to be talking about Catherine Trotter Cockburn here. She lived from 1679 to 1749. She has kind of a sad life. Her dad died when she was 4 years old, leaving their family financially destitute. I think this is like a recurring theme with all the women philosophers. Like, there's some tragedy in their lives. Yeah, I don't know what that says about them. According to an early source that knows her, she taught herself French, Latin, Greek, and logic. She was somewhat of a prodigy child and wrote several plays in her teens, which were wildly successful. She enjoyed even a little bit of like fame and notoriety because of the success of these plays. In 1708, she marries a man named Cockburn, and she takes time off and raises a large family. But once her children are raised, she goes right back into doing philosophy and other writing. So our current reading is her defense of Locke. But in addition to that, she's made important contributions to philosophy by publishing other things, like a kind of nuanced defense of a quasi-Lockean moral philosophy in this long-titled book. She also wrote several works of theology, and this biographer, Thomas Birch, had approached her about publishing a collection of her written works and correspondence, which was done in 1751, a couple years after she died. I think that's pretty impressive. I mean, here's a woman writer, a woman philosopher, who makes so many, has been so successful as a writer that in her own lifetime, there are people who say, we need to collect all of your writings together and publish them in one collected volume so that people can have access to that. So I think we're starting to see some more success that women are having in writing and doing philosophy. This piece that we're reading is her defense of Locke. The piece is in response to a pamphlet that Thomas Burnett wrote. Now, Burnett wrote it anonymously, and this is the sort of thing that happened in this time. People would propose ideas, would write books, and then people would attack it by publishing these little pamphlets that might be like 50 to 100 pages long. She read this guy's pamphlet, thought it was so bad, and if you read this piece, her tone in here is very condescending. Like, she's definitely like throwing the smack down on this guy, being like, you don't know what you're talking about, you've misunderstood Locke, how can I make this any clearer? She was very impressed with Locke's philosophy and felt compelled to defend him from Burnett's attack. And so this piece that we read was published in 1702 anonymously. Which, by the way, many people attributed to John Locke. So, kudos to her for writing so well. Locke was pleased with her work and grateful for her help, and so he honored her work by giving her money and books. You might think, you know, the money I get, what's the deal with the books? When you think about this, I mean, she doesn't come from a family of nobility. She doesn't have access to a lot of books. And for somebody who's a writer and a philosopher, that's a really big commodity. Like, they could not get books like we can get books today. I mean, we can just get just about anything we want. I mean, if not through the internet, then we can get it pretty quickly, like even through our libraries and things. Like, they don't have the kinds of access to resources and books and information that we have today. And so private collections of books were really important. Burnett's attacks on Locke's philosophy focus on the suitability of Locke's philosophy to provide a basis for Christian morality and the afterlife. And so Cockburn's response kind of focuses on three lines of reasoning. One, that Locke has provided a sufficient epistemology for morality, a way of knowing moral truth. Secondly, that nothing Locke has written implies the soul is not immortal. And third, that morality may be known through a natural conscience, a human ability to judge our actions as being right or wrong according to some rule or principle. Our reading is all about the second one. Nothing in our reading speaks really anything to the first or the third. There's one line in there that maybe does, but everything from our reading is really about number two here. So the way that I've ordered my notes for this consists in, imagine like if you're going through the reading, the way that I took my notes in this is that I noted every time she kind of said that the objector or the remarker claims this. So I've noted this in terms of, she kind of highlights, here's an objection to Locke's view, here's my response. So the first objection shows up on page 129, and it's kind of a summary here, that the following two claims are a threat to the doctrine of the immortality of the soul. One, that the soul may be sometimes absolutely without any thoughts, and secondly, that God could have given matter the power to think. The things we're going to be talking about here are related a lot to what we just did about personal identity, but it's also going to be related to the stuff about sleep that we did at the beginning. Yeah, go ahead.
Is this one of Burnett's objections or one of
Burnett's?
Okay.
So the objections will be Burnett's, and then the responses up here are going to be Cockburn. Now, the first thing that I take her to be saying in response to this is that this whole line of reasoning is a non sequitur. Anybody ever use this word, know what this word means for something being a non sequitur? Yeah.
Something that doesn't really address the point, it's just kind of like tangential. It's not even tangentially related, it's just completely off topic.
Yeah, it literally means like it doesn't follow. So, to say, I mean, that the soul might sometimes be without any thoughts and God could have given matter the power to think, how does it follow from those claims that the soul is not immortal? She's just going to say that it just makes no sense that those would be concerns, that those have anything to do with immortality of the soul. So to claim that immortality requires, she's going to kind of turn the table on him, and this is a theme throughout the reading. To require that the soul must always be thinking in order to be to have immortality is to place the doctrine of immortality of the soul on a very unsure foundation. Rhetorically, one of the things she does throughout the reading in response to Locke is she's saying, or in response to Burnett, is you keep trying to say that in order for us for there to be immortality, the soul must always be thinking, or it must be impossible for matter to think. Well, you're the one putting the higher requirements for the doctrine to work out. So, Locke's view is less committal than your view. We'll have more to say about how that works. Let's go to something a little bit more specific. If the soul is utterly without thoughts, if you remember from the first week we covered Locke, he has this idea that the essence of the soul is not to think, that it's possible for there to be a soul that is completely devoid of thought. Well, and so he says, well, here's a problem with that. If the soul can utterly be without any thoughts at all, what would it initiate the next new thought? How could it start thinking again? This was not the question I had you write on, was it? This was the one. So let me, before I put up some answers, if you can recall, what are some of the things that you pulled out? I have identified three different things that she said, so it's not just one thing. Yeah, Colin.
She said that he doesn't believe in innate ideas, so how could a new thought impress on or something like that?
That's right. One of the things she does, she turns the tables on him in a lot of her responses. And so the only way that you could make your soul continuously have new thoughts, for your soul to continuously be entertaining thoughts, is if there are innate ideas. And she's going to argue that's not going to work out. I'm going to bring more details up. That's right. One of the lines has to do with attacking innate ideas. It's another thing that she brings up.
Did you bring up memory?
In what ways?
I don't know. I'm kind of confused by that. Like that, no matter what, you always have memories and you want to learn the line.
So, let's see.
I thought that was where like innate ideas came into play when she was when they were talking about memory. That somebody said they were ingrained in the soul.
I see.
They said if they were ingrained in the soul, then how could he believe in innate ideas?
Yeah.
So, this is one of the things that she says in response to this is that memories are different from innate ideas. When you remember something, there's this kind of like recollection of like, I remember that. But innate ideas, whenever like somebody, the first time somebody proves, let's say, you know, the Pythagorean theorem to you, you don't go, oh, I remember that. That's just like how I recall it. It's like a brand new experience. You go, wow, that's amazing. But we don't react that way. So that's part of her case against innate ideas there, that memory and innate ideas do not operate like memory, so they're not remembrances, they're brand new things. Yeah?
She attacks, like, well, we don't understand how the soul thinks at all, so how can we expect to understand what initiates thought?
Yeah, this is, I think, the first thing, I'll go ahead and get this one up, that we don't know how the soul works. And so it would be unsound to conclude that since we don't know how it produces something, that it follows the soul is incapable of producing it. So Locke has he's very clear about this, that we don't really know much about what a soul or an immaterial substance, if it exists, what it's like or how it operates. But that doesn't mean that it doesn't operate, or it can't do these things. Like, if you don't know how your car works, the fact that you don't know, like, how turning a key starts the engine, that doesn't mean that you have to understand how it works in order for it to work. All you need to know is when I stick the key in and turn, it starts. Most of the time. The Locke is going to say kind of the same thing about a soul. We don't know how the soul works, but you don't need to know how it works in order to know that it does work. So, the only way that you could really make this kind of case that, you know, that it's impossible for the soul to start up a new idea if it's utterly void of thought would be if you understand how this works. If you say the only way that you can get a new thought or start a new thought is from a continuing of an old thought, then you would be able to make this case. But we don't know how the soul works. So one other one in between these two. So between we don't know how it works and issues with innate ideas. I don't know if anybody picked up on it, but I'll get it. Any other thoughts people might have had? Yeah?
There's something about when you go to sleep and then thoughts stop and you wake up, then what would... Because it happens, mm-hmm. right? It happens. You can't really say this because it doesn't make sense in my context.
That's the idea that I think makes up this next one. So, she says, if the author, the remarker, is right, then we must have a new soul every single morning, because there goes some point at night when our minds are completely devoid of thought. We don't constantly have a string of conscious thoughts continuously going every moment. So if this guy's right, that you would be a new person without that stream of consciousness, then I guess every morning we wake up, we're a brand new person, according to him. That's, you know, ridiculous. So if he's saying, in order to continuously be the same person, your soul must constantly be filled with thoughts, then we're not the same person. She compares this to your body, because what Locke wants to say is that your mind, or the soul, one of the operations of the soul is to think. But there might be other things the soul does as well. It's not the only thing the soul does. The body, likewise, one of the things it does is move, but that's not the only thing it does. The body does other things as well. So would he say that if you know, for your body to continuously be the same body, it must always be moving? And if it stopped moving, how would it ever start up again? She wants to make that kind of comparison that it's silly to think that the body would be subject to these exact same objections, so they wouldn't really stick to the soul either. And then the third one is what we were talking about first, which is that how does he answer the objection that how would he try to account for the idea that we constantly, that we are able to think about the same thing over and over again? Let's take a quick look at this on 134. And I want to start on the bottom, about four lines from the bottom on 134. So, she says, "This is a sure consequence. If, when all our thoughts cease, all our ideas must be new impressed, unless a man could actually perceive all the ideas he ever had at once, for his having only one thought in his mind can no more keep any other there or excite any other, that it has no connection with, than if he had no thought at all." And she goes on to give this example of like a horse. So say, let me give you a different kind of example. Let's say I tell you to think about something in particular right now. Like, think about, you know, a blue water buffalo. And, you know, let's name them, you know. If you want to call him George, let's call him George. Give your blue water buffalo whatever name you want to give him. And then I say, forget about George for a moment. Let's talk about Locke or Cockburn or something else. You know, let's talk about, you know, dead bunnies. I don't know. All right, George is out of your mind. But now I say, now let's come back and talk about George again. Can you think about George one more time? But, you know, can you think about how many legs he has or how big he is? How did you, if this guy is right, how is it that we can keep the same ideas that pass in and out of consciousness? Because it seems like what he's trying to say is you've got to keep these same ideas together, or else it's not the same ideas. The minute you stop thinking about them, and then you think about them brand new again, it's almost like you're initiating a new idea altogether. If he's right, then we never can really hold the same ideas, because we're never holding that same thought before our mind from beginning to end. We constantly have our thoughts interrupted,